Good afternoon, everyone. And welcome to your worship here in Eglish this Sunday. You're very welcome as we gather to praise the Lord together. As we begin, I want to read a couple of verses from Psalm 98, verses 4 and 5, where we read this. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing. Let's stand and do that as we sing together a hymn based on that psalm. Sing to God new songs of worship. All his deeds are marvelous. Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are the God of all righteousness, the God of all glory, the God of all holiness and justice and greatness and goodness, that you're the God who's worthy of all our praise, all our adoration, that you're the God who even now is seated on the throne of heaven. And we thank you, Lord, that you call us and give us the blessing of worshiping you, that you give us the blessing of being able to praise you as a congregation here Sunday by Sunday. We thank you that we can praise you for who you are, that you are the God who has done marvelous things, the God who has granted us salvation through your Son, the Lord Jesus. The God who has met with us through your Holy Spirit. And we pray that again today you would meet with us afresh through your Spirit. That you would meet with us to teach us and bless us. That you would meet with us, that you would be honored amongst us. Lord, we thank you that you are the God who offers us salvation, in Christ. And we, as we come now in him, we pray, Lord, and ask for your forgiveness. We ask for forgiveness for those ways in which we have lived our way and not yours this past week. Those ways in which we have dishonored you with our thoughts or our words or our actions. Those sins, we ask forgiveness for those sins which we have committed, and those good things that we should have done that we didn't do. We ask forgiveness, Lord. Father, we ask that you would come and teach us now. We pray for the children through in Sunday school. We ask for your hand upon them. We ask that as they meet together that they would know you speaking to them through your word. And as we turn to your word now, we pray, Lord, that you would open it to us. Give us understanding, give us insight, give us direction. Lord, that we would know you speaking into our hearts, into our lives, into our minds. Lord, and that as we know you speaking to us, that you would work in our lives and compel us to obey and respond in faith and love and obedience. Lord, we look to you now and we ask that you would be honored amongst us, and that all the glory would go to you through Christ our Lord. Amen. So we turn again to the story of Abraham. We're coming to the last two or three weeks, a couple of weeks after this one. And we turn this morning to Genesis 23. And we read verses 1 to 20. And you can find it on page 23 in the Pew Bibles as well. Genesis 23. Genesis 23, let us hear the word of God. Sarah lived to be 127 years old. She died at Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron in the land of Canaan. And Abraham went to mourn for Sarah and to weep over her. Then Abraham rose from beside his dead wife and spoke to the Hittites. He said, "I am an alien and a stranger among you. Sell me some property for a burial site here, so that I can bury my dead." The Hittites replied to Abraham, "Sir, listen to us. You are a mighty prince among us. Bury your dead in the choicest of our tombs. None of us will refuse you his tomb for burying your dead." Then Abraham rose and bowed down before the people of the land, the Hittites. He said to them, "If you are willing to let me bury my dead, then listen to me and intercede with Ephron, son of Zohar, on my behalf, so that he will sell me the cave of Machpelah, which belongs to him and is at the end of his field. Ask him to sell it to me for the full price as a burial site among you." Ephron the Hittite was sitting among his people, and he replied to Abraham in the hearing of all the Hittites who had come to the gate of his city, "No, my lord," he said, "listen to me. I give you the field, and I give you the cave that is in it. I give it to you in the presence of my people. Bury your dead." Again, Abraham bowed down before the people of the land. And he said to Ephron in their hearing, "Listen to me, if you will. I will pay the price of the field. Accept it from me, so that I can bury my dead there." Ephron answered Abraham, "Listen to me, my lord. The land is worth 400 shekels of silver, but what is that among me and you? Bury your dead." Abraham agreed to Ephron's terms and weighed out for him the price he had named in the hearing of the Hittites, 400 shekels of silver, according to the weight current among the merchants. So Ephron's field in Machpelah near Mamre, both the field and the cave in it, and all the trees within the borders of the field, was legally made over to Abraham as his property in the presence of all the Hittites who had come to the gate of the city. Afterwards, Abraham buried his wife Sarah in the cave of the, in the field of Machpelah near Mamre, which is at Hebron, in the land of Canaan. So the field and the cave in it were legally made over to Abraham by the Hittites as a burial site. Amen. We thank the Lord for this reading of his word. Before we study that passage together, we're going to stand and sing together number 276, The Bible Tells of God's Great Plan. Let's pray. Father, we want to echo those words that we have just sung. We thank you firstly for the reminder that still you speak today. And we pray you'd help us to hear what you're saying to us. And we pray also, Lord, that as we've sung, that we would learn to do your will. Lord, teach us your will. And not just teach it to us, but help us to do it. Not just to be hearers, but doers of your word. So come and help us, lead us through your word, and bless us, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Sometimes you come to a Bible passage and you wonder, what exactly is it that the writer is trying to get across to us in this passage? And that's, I think, is maybe the case here. You look at it and you think, what is it that Moses wants us to take from this? What is the point he's trying to make? Yes, here it records for us the death of Sarah at the grand old age of 127, but from there it goes on to become an account of how Abraham bought a field and a cave to bury Sarah in. Why is this? Why does Moses take one verse to record Sarah's death before going on to take 10 times that to tell the story of Abraham buying this burial plot? Well, to help us understand what's going on here, or to help us see what Moses wants us to see, I think we need to see a couple of details that he puts in at the start and at the end. At first reading, you maybe didn't even notice them. They maybe don't seem that important. And yet I think Moses has put them there for a reason. We see in verse 2, for example, that Sarah died at Kiriath Arba, that's Hebron, in the land of Canaan. So that's at the start. And then at the end, verse 19, we read that she was buried in the cave of the field of Machpelah near Mamre, which is at Hebron, in the land of Canaan. What is it that Moses wants us to see? What's the significance here for the people then and for us? Well, I think it says that Moses wants us to see not just the faith of Abraham, but even more so the faithfulness of God, the faithfulness of God in fulfilling his promises here, and the beginning here of this promise being fulfilled. If you remember back to when Abraham first came into Canaan. So it was 65 years before this in Genesis 12, and God promised to him, to your offspring, I will give this land. So God has promised them this land, and this is the first plot of land that Abraham or his offspring receive. And so here we see this promise beginning to come to fulfillment. Here we see this promise beginning to be fulfilled here. And Moses is saying, yes, see what Abraham does in faith, but even more so see the faithfulness of God, the God who keeps his promises, the God whose word we can trust, the God we can trust with our today, but also with our tomorrow. That's what we see here. And I want to look at it under three P's. Verses 1 and 2, that we can trust God through our pain. And verses 3 to 16, the big chunk in the middle where we see this buying of land, we can trust God as pilgrims. And verses 17 to 20, we can trust God in his promises. So pain, pilgrim, and promises. So firstly, we can trust God through our pain. So as I've said, Sarah lived to this ripe old age of 127. And Abraham, we see, went to mourn for her and weep over her. Now, other than the age, the rest seems normal enough there. You would expect a husband to mourn for his wife, to weep over her. That's normal. But there are a few things that are special about this death here. We see, for example, that Sarah is the only woman who has her age recorded for us, only age at death recorded for us in Genesis. And Sarah, we see, not just here, but I think in her story as a whole, it's the mother of faith. We see Abraham as the father of faith, the father of those who believe, but Sarah here is the mother of those who believe. But also we see then in Abraham's mourning, the reminder that death isn't how things were meant to be. The death is an intruder. The death is an unwelcome guest. A guest whose presence causes us to mourn and to grieve and to weep. Abraham mourns Sarah's loss. A reminder that we do the same, but that we can trust God through our pain, just as he does here. But mourning isn't the focus of the passage here. It's recorded in just a verse or two. Instead, we see this large middle section running from 3 to 16, and I've called it trusting God as pilgrims. I'll explain why I've used pilgrims in a minute. The word pilgrim maybe brings to mind the book Pilgrim's Progress, or maybe the Pilgrim's Fathers who were the first people to move from England or Europe to America to set up home there. But the fact that Christians are pilgrims goes back much further than that. One could argue to hear verse 4, where Abraham describes himself as an alien and a stranger. He's an alien and a stranger, someone who's come from the outside, someone who really belongs elsewhere and is moving on elsewhere. Someone who's come to the land in faith, on a journey of faith, but is trusting God in this journey. He comes as an alien and a stranger, and he comes looking to buy this property so he can bury Sarah. But notice the reply in verse 6. They said to him, the Hittites said to him, but you're a mighty prince among us. Or it could be translated, you are a prince of God among us. He's come from the outside. He's come as an outsider. But Abraham has been a blessing to them. You see, God had said among the promises, a promise he'd made to Abraham was, I will bless you so that you will be a blessing to others. I will bless you so you will be a blessing to others. And here we see how he's been a blessing to the Hittites, that they recognize or call him a prince among them or a prince of God among them. They can see God's hand upon him. And it's because of that, they say, you don't need to buy a tomb. You can bury your wife in the choicest of our tombs. But before I get back into the details of the story, let's think about this alien and stranger idea, this pilgrim idea. Because this isn't the only place in the Bible where we see this. We see it in Hebrews 11, reminds us that that's how Abraham and Sarah thought of themselves.
Then, back in the Old Testament, Leviticus 25, the Lord tells the people of Israel that when they go into the Promised Land, they were to think of themselves as aliens and strangers, as pilgrims. Verse 39, where David speaks of himself as an alien and stranger, and then he says, as all my fathers were. So David says that. And then 1 Peter, he begins a long exhortation with these words, "Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers." Why this theme running through the Bible? What is it that these verses and these writers are trying to say to us? Well, they're saying to us, that's the attitude that we should have. That we should think of ourselves as aliens and strangers in this world. That if we've come to Christ, if we are believers in the Lord Jesus, we are those whose citizenship is in heaven. That we are those who belong in heaven. That we are just passing through this world. I was reading this week about a story about a man called Carl Ludwig Schmidt, who, as you'll guess, was German. And Schmidt was a New Testament professor in Germany in the 1930s. And he was given the job. They were writing a New Testament dictionary at the time, and he had to write an article looking at the word paroikos, which gives us the word stranger. But also at that time where he was doing this writing, he also wrote an article criticizing the Nazis. Now, as you'll understand, that didn't go down well in Germany at that time. So he's sacked from his job and thrown out of the country, and his citizenship was taken off him. So he ended up going to Switzerland, and he wrote the article on what the Bible means about being an alien and a stranger. He wrote it as a stranger in Switzerland. That biblical word came with a new meaning for him. He was an alien and a stranger, just as we are called to think of ourselves. That we are to live for the world to come rather than the world we're in. But our problem is that we forget this. Or we imbibe or take in the thinking of this world, that this world is all there is. During the week, I was reading from 2 Peter. And in 2 Peter, we can read how Peter calls teachers of his day, a certain number of teachers in his day, scoffers. These were false teachers who were scoffing at the idea that Jesus would come again. They said, Jesus isn't coming again. This world will continue as it has forever. Jesus won't return. That was what those false teachers were teaching. Now, I'm not aware of that false teaching in the church today, but it is the teaching or the thinking of the world that we live in. People live without regard to God, without thinking of Jesus' return. People living as if this world is all there is. And if we end up thinking that this world is all there is, we end up making idols of things of this world, whether they be popularity or politics or prestige or property or power or pound signs, instead of looking to the God who is the God of promise. We need to be those who remember this world is not our home. We have another home to look to. We need to be living as pilgrims, thinking as pilgrims, and looking to the Lord and his return. As I've said a number of times in this series, there are different times where Abraham ends up living with what we could call 2D thinking. Times where he left God out of the picture, where he made decisions based upon his thinking, his mind, and didn't think, what is it that God's calling me to do? What's God's plan in this? Well, here Abraham has got his 3D lenses on. He's looking to God. He's looking to the reality of God. And it's because of that he wants to buy this land in obedience to God's promise. In obedience to the promise where God said, I will give this land to your offspring. He said, I'm claiming this for God. I'm buying this land, this field, in obedience to God. Now, he could have easily gone back to Haran, back where he'd come from, but he doesn't. Because he's committed to the promise of God, and he's acting in faith
to God's promises. He's trusting in God, looking to him. He buys the land. He's told you can have it, but he says, I don't want to be given it. I don't want to borrow it. I want to buy it, so there's no dispute over who owns this. There's no questioning the fact that I'm the legal owner. And this land will prove significant in the years to come. Sarah's buried in it here. Abraham himself will be buried in it. Isaac, Rebecca, Jacob. And even Joseph, when he's prime minister in Egypt, will leave instructions that when he dies, his body is to be taken in a coffin out of Egypt, back up to Canaan to be buried there on this land, in this cave. But when we look at the details here, it's fascinating how it all works out. We see these Hittites mentioned a number of times. So they were witnesses of the process. We then see this Ephron character who offers the land at a price, 400 shekels of silver, a price well above the going rate. That was more than the average worker got paid in a year. So a high price for a field. But Abraham doesn't argue, he doesn't barter, he simply agrees to the terms, weighs out the silver in the way they used to do it in those days, and pays the money. But why does he pay it? Because he's living as a pilgrim, looking to God, looking to God's promises, using his money in the light of God's word. Using this money so that this tiny chunk of Canaan becomes his in honor of God's promise. So he's trusting God, and he's trusting God in his promise, verses 17 to 20. At harvest time, or if you look at the harvest passages in the Bible, something that's spoken about is the first fruits of the harvest. And this was the first fruits of the crop that were given as an offering to God. The first fruits that were given as a promise of more to come when the full harvest came in. They were a down payment, if you like, a down payment that was given with the promise of more. Well, this part of this field, this cave that Abraham buys is a bit like the first fruits. It's a down payment. It's a down payment acknowledging that under God, there's more to come. That field is not all that God is going to give, but God has promised the land to the people. So we see what happens here, that the field is legally made over to Abraham. He buys it not to expand or start a property portfolio, but as an act of faith, an act of saying, God has promised us this land, so I'm going to buy this in obedience to God. This was a place significant to them. This was the place where the angel of the Lord had met with them years before and promised that Isaac would be born in a year to them, as he was. And so Abraham does this in obedience to God. This piece of land is a down payment with the promise that more will come. A promise that the land of Canaan, of which this was a part, as we saw in verses 2 and verses 19, would be given to the people of God. Now, this wasn't a promise that Abraham saw fulfilled. But as we see in Hebrews 11, he kept on longing for a better country, a heavenly one. He kept believing for more and looking to the heavenly country that God had prepared for him. You know, if you're a Christian, if you've given your life to Jesus, you have received a down payment. You've received the first fruits, the first installment of God's blessing that encourages you to keep looking for more, to keep longing for that heavenly country. If we've come to Jesus, we've received forgiveness for our past, God's presence in the present, and hope for the future. We've had hope to look to. And so we have this down payment, the forgiveness of the Father, our relationship with Jesus, the blessing and presence of the Holy Spirit, all so precious to us now. But the promise more, that point us to that day when we'll receive the full riches, the full blessing of God's promise. That's what God holds out to us. That this world isn't all there is, but that there's more to come. There's more for those whose trust is in Jesus. You know, Genesis 23
Maybe it didn't look like much, but here we see the promises of God beginning to be fulfilled. Here we see this small sign of God's faithfulness, a small sign that reminds us there's more to come. There was more to come for Abraham and the people, but there's more for us as well. That God hasn't finished his blessing. God hasn't finished with his promises. But that God holds out for us the hope of heaven, the hope of eternity. So let's look to it. Let's not get so consumed in this world that we forget that God has more for us. Let's look to his promises and let's trust him in his faithfulness. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that for Abraham there was more. That this piece of land in Hebron and the land of Canaan wasn't all that there was. But then that in your mercy, you did an entire land for him and for his people that they would receive in due time. Father, we thank you that in Christ, this world is not all there is. Indeed, that the blessings you've given us are not all there is. Yes, Lord, we're so thankful. We're so thankful for the forgiveness you've given us, for the relationship we have with Jesus, for the blessing of your Holy Spirit. We're so thankful for these things. But we're thankful, Lord, that you promise us more as well, that you hold out to us eternal blessings. You hold out to us the hope of heaven. You hold out to us that day when we will see Jesus face to face. Lord, help us to look forward. Help us to trust you for today, but also to trust you for tomorrow. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, knowing that in Christ there's always more to come. Father, help us to look to eternity, the hope that's ours in Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Oops. Okay, at this point, I have a few announcements before the children join us. And firstly, to mention Youth Fellowship's on tonight in the hall, so that's at 7:30. So that's 7:30, Youth Fellowship this evening. Then next Sunday, as well as our usual midday service, we have an evening service. So it's in the Atchison Hall next week, and our guest speaker is Leslie Holmes. Leslie had come and shared with us here in Eglish just before lockdown, speaking about the work of Good News for Everyone, which used to be Gideon's UK, and he's going to bring us an update next week. So we look forward to that. So that's 7 o'clock next Sunday evening in the Atchison Hall. And also just to mention again, or to mention at this stage, to highlight the Midweek Bible Study. This week's in Eglish, so it's 8 o'clock on Wednesday. And can encourage you to think about coming with three left before the summer break, before we move to our summer prayer. So this Wednesday we meet 17th, 8 o'clock in Eglish, and as I say, I very much encourage you to join us for that as we look at 1 Peter. So at this point we turn to prayer. Are the boys and girls, do you want to come in? Morning, everybody. Good to see you. Okay, let's pray. Father, we thank you that in your mercy we can turn to you, that in Christ we can know you as our God, that in Christ we have all the riches of your blessing, and also we have the promise and hope of eternity.
Father, we pray you'd bless us now as we turn to you in prayer. We thank you that you hear us. We thank you that you know us. We thank you that you love us. And as we come in prayer, we thank you that as we pray here, that Jesus is in heaven interceding for us, praying for us. And Lord, as we pray, we want to pray for the local council elections taking place this week. We pray for that the men and women of your choosing would be elected. And that as they're elected, we pray you'd help them to serve with integrity, with diligence, with wisdom, that you would help them to serve with faithfulness. And we pray you'd guide us as we bring our votes, that you would lead us in our voting, that you would help us to honour you as we do that. We also pray, Lord, for our P7s as they find out next Saturday that the school they will be attending next year. We pray that you'd bless them and that they would be attending the school that is best for them, somewhere there where they would be happy and settle in and feel at home quickly. Lord, we pray for them at this important time and this time of adjustment that they would know your blessing and your help. We pray also for our farmers at this busy time of year as they begin cutting the silage. We pray for them, grant them safety as they do that and their other important tasks on the farm. Pray that they would know your presence as they go about their work day by day. Lord, we pray also for the moderator at this time as he heads off to the Middle East this week, to Syria and Lebanon. Lord, we know those places have suffered so much in recent years through war and also through earthquake. And we pray that as he goes there, that the Reverend Dr. John Kirkpatrick would be a blessing, that you would help him to be an encouragement to the churches there. We thank you for the churches, that they've continued to trust you and stand for you. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to use your church in those lands, that you would help them as they seek to reach out to those around them. We know that those are predominantly Muslim countries, but we pray, Lord, that by your Spirit, you would help the church to shine for you and reach out with the good news of Jesus and make a difference for you. We pray you bless them even now as they meet for worship today. Lord, as we meet, we also want to remember those who are unwell. We think of those who are sick, both within the congregation, but also within our families, our wider families. Lord, we pray that you would draw alongside to bring healing and strength and comfort. Lord, we pray for ourselves and we bring our own prayers to you. You know those things that are on our minds, those things that we've been praying about over the course of the week, and we take a moment again now just to bring those things to you in the silence. Father, we look to you. We thank you that you are the God who answers prayer, the God who hears prayer. And we continue in our worship in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to stand and sing together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. To Calvary, and there
Hand over to Owen.
Good afternoon, boys and girls. So today in church, we were learning about something very sad that happened. Sarah has came to the end of her life, and we see how Abraham cries for her, as all of us would. And it could be so easy for me to just go, that's too sad, let's move on, let's move away, let's do something different. But death is something that's really real in life. And although it's hard and that it's sad, we have to remember that God is still good and that he loves us and he cares for us. So I brought with me a little book that I used with Micah last year after my daddy passed away, just to help him wrestle with it. And I think it's really good. You've maybe seen it before. It's called The Moon Is Always Round. Now, in it, the daddy, so it usually goes, Dad said, the moon is always round. So whenever I say, Dad said, I want you to join in and say, the moon is always round. Okay? So we're going to give it a trial run. So 1, 2, 3. Dad said, okay, great. So let's do that. And although this is a sad book, it is important that we do it. And if you want to talk to myself or Mark afterwards, please do so, and we'll support you through it. And it's okay to get upset or to be sad, even in church, because God still loves us and we have hope, okay? So, when I look up on a sunny day, the sky is blue and bright, and jet planes paint white lines on its canvas. When I look up on a stormy day, the sky is grey and dull, and clouds pour rain, and flash and boom with lightning and thunder. When I look up on a summer's evening, the sky is red and purpley pink. The sun looks like it's falling from the sky on fire. When I look up on a clear night, the sky is dark and the stars twinkle and sparkle like diamonds. But the moon isn't always round. Dad said, the moon is always round, even when you can't see all of it. When Dad told me that I was getting a little sister, the moon looked like a banana. But Dad said, the moon is always round. When the crib was being put together, the moon looked like a slice of apple. But Dad said, the moon is always round. When Mummy's tummy began to look like a watermelon, the moon looked like a shriveled orange. But Dad said, the moon is always round. Even when I was told that my little sister wasn't coming to live with us after all, After all the waiting, Dad said, "The moon is always round." When my parents left in the middle of the night for the hospital, and the next morning I went off to preschool, I thought, "Will the moon be round tonight?" Dad said, "The moon is always round." When I waited at the hospital to meet my little sister, I was left and we left without her. I said, "Why, Daddy?" He replied, "I don't know why, but the moon is always round." When I got home from the hospital, I looked for the moon before bed. It was a half moon. But Dad said, "The moon is always round." And when it was still just the three of us, and we went to church to say goodbye, my dad asked me, "What shape is the moon?" I said, "The moon is always round." And Dad said, "What does that mean?" I said, "God is always good." And then this can be a little bit of a memory verse for today. And it says, For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. And his faithfulness to all generations. Now, I know that was sad, but there's something very important for us to remember and to take away from it whenever we see the moon and remember it. Maybe I can't even remember what it's like in a minute. I probably did see it yesterday. Probably it's not quite full because we're not long after Easter. But just because we can't always see God's goodness, so whenever you think of the moon, think of God's goodness, even when you can't see it, or maybe you can only see a little bit of it during difficult times, it does not mean that God is not good in those times. God is always good, just as the moon is always round, even when you can't see it. Just like the moon is always round, even when you can't see it, God is always good. So please do remember our little verse, and I'll say it again. I should have had the words up on the screen so we could have said it together, but please just listen to it very carefully as I read it again. It's from Psalm 100, and it's verse 5, and it is, "For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." So even from the youngest of us here to the oldest, God loves us. He has always loved us and will always love us. And will be with us, even whenever things are dark or difficult or a struggle. Okay? So please do remember that. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to just remember your love for us at this time, that you are always good, you're always loving, and you're always kind. Even whenever we can't see it, even whenever things are difficult and hard, Lord, we know that you're there for us. And Lord, we pray that you'll help us to remember that, that we will cling close to you whenever we need you. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. We are now going to stand and sing together, "By Faith We See the Hand of God." So let's stand and sing that now.
Lives of those who prove his faithfulness.
And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and forevermore. Amen.